Okay, this is good. I'm having to goggle up. That tells me that it's getting real. So this is my dad, and this is his front porch. And what do you see from your front porch?
18 pecan trees.
And why are pecan trees important to our family?
Because that was a punishment that I had after I got caught hot rodding my daddy's 62 Ford. And he said, well, what do you want? You want to be grounded or you want a whipping? I said, I'd rather have the whipping. And he said, let me think about it. I'll get back with you in a couple of days. So he went to work and asked his friends at work what he should do.
At NASA.
And one of those guys says, you've been wanting some pecan trees, Fess. I would put that boy in your blue truck, take him down to South Georgia, and I'd get some pecan seedlings, bring them back, and I'd make that boy plant pecan trees in your yard. It took me all summer to do it. A 5-foot pecan tree has about a 5-foot taproot. So you got to dig a deep hole.
So the idea was something that you wouldn't forget?
Yes, and it worked. Every day when I come out and I see these pecan limbs laying on the ground and you have to have a burn pile to burn them, that punishment goes on after 1967.
And granddaddy's long gone and you're still getting punished for hot rodding the Ford.
I am. There's a pecan tree right there.
So obviously pecan trees have had a special place in the heart of my family for a while because pecans 96. Are awesome.
96 was a good year for pecans here.
Pecan from 1996. Here we go. Here's a pecan. It tastes like butter pecan ice cream.
Second one's better than the first one.
Pecans make everything better, from pies to cakes to breads to toppings. Seriously, if you haven't tried it yet, your favorite flavor ice cream is buttered pecan. You just don't know it yet. Yes, I grew up in the shade of those 18 trees my dad planted as punishment, but I've never seen how a pecan farm goes about shaking hundreds of pounds of pecans out of these gigantic trees. So when I got a call from a local farmer named Frank saying he was going to be shaking some of his pecan trees on his 400 tree orchard, it was only appropriate that my dad should join me on this trip out to the pecan farm.
How's it going?
Hey, good.
Nice to meet you.
Yeah, good meeting you.
I want to make sure I understand correctly. You literally grab the tree and shake it.
Yes, exactly. We grab the tree. I'm going to show you the shaker over
okay.
here.
Yeah.
This is a Savage shaker. This arm slides out. You back up and then squeeze the
Oh,
tree.
Look at that. So the tree
goes right in between here, this rubber cushion.
Uh-huh. So it doesn't damage the tree?
Does not damage the tree.
Okay.
You tighten up on a tree so it's real tight so it doesn't come loose. And then when you engage the PTO, it violently shakes the tree and the nuts come tumbling down.
Really?
Oh my goodness. It's a lobe? Is it offset?
Just
like a motor on a cell phone.
So I'm seeing a rotating shaft, mm-hmm. just like a cell phone vibration motor.
Okay.
But why does the chain go that way? I don't understand what happens way.
It goes down to where the gearbox or the PTO is.
Okay. Oh, where's the PTO?
See, it comes in right down at the bottom here.
Oh, okay. So it's driven here.
Yeah.
It shakes
it's
there.
Driven down here, shakes up here.
And this whole thing is mechanically coupled, so this just shakes like that.
Yes.
Okay. That makes sense.
I didn't know this, but there are over 500 different varieties of pecans. Frank grows two different varieties on his farm.
This is the Pawnee.
Okay.
Ripens usually the end of September, first week October. And this is a Kiowa, and it ripens the first week of November usually. The Pawnee is richer. It's got more oil in it, so it's a more buttery flavor. The Kiowa is bigger, so if you want to make a pie with big nuts on top, this is the ones you want to put on top. But if you want in the meat of the pie, you want to put Pawnee because it's rich. It's like the butter you put in the crust.
Right? Gonna try the buttery flavor?
That's not the buttery flavor. This is the buttery flavor.
Okay, so this is a
dryer.
Kiowa.
This is a dryer.
And this is the Pawnee?
Yes.
Way higher. The quality is way better.
It is.
Weird.
Pecans are all so different. I mean, every pecan. So whether you have Elias or Schley or Pawnee or Kiowas or, you know, there's so many different varieties.
Can I eat that?
Yeah.
It was really good.
Yeah, of course.
You grow up knowing something and then you learn something and you get an understanding. So we're moving from knowledge to understanding. when it comes to pecans. This is awesome.
So it was time to see this thing in action. Frank opened the jaws of the shaker wide so it would fit around the trunk of the tree. He backs in and then tightened the jaws snug around the tree so it won't hurt the bark of the tree when he engages the shaker.
Shoot, you were right. Golly. Okay, that's amazing. Did a lot come out?
A lot of leaves came out. I don't know about pecans.
Well, one donked me right on the noggin, man. All right, so post-shake, let's look at what we got. So one left that hole. I still got one in this one. So like right at the base of the pecan where it goes into the hole, yeah. There's a connected point.
Right.
Does that have to dry out in order for this to work?
The husk has to be open for the nut to fall out.
Okay.
And this year, they have not been acting as normal. The husks have not opened on time. Well, I don't know why. They were ripe, they just didn't open up, and then I couldn't shake them. So everything is about 3 weeks late.
So Dad's gonna be the tripod on the tractor today. We're gonna use the high-speed camera like this, and the idea is maybe we can get up in tops of the trees or wherever we need to get. So I'm so excited about a high-speed camera mounted on a tractor.
This was admittedly a redneck move, but it worked like a charm and was super convenient. What you're about to see is without a doubt one of the most chaotic and complicated mechanical systems I have ever seen. I was astounded at the complexity.
So this is all about like mechanical vibration.
It is mechanical vibration.
So I have another question then.
Sure.
So it seems to me that if you were to shake the tree in this axis, it would behave differently than if you were to turn 90 degrees and shake in this axis.
We have never done that, shaking them from different sides, not normally, but that's an idea that might give you better results if you took the time to go to every tree multiple directions.
But when you're going, you're just going. You don't care about that.
We want to get trees on nuts on the ground so I can harvest them, and then we've got to usually have a crew standing by to start processing them.
So what effect would shaking a tree from two different angles actually have? I wanted to see what would happen way up in the top of the tree, so I locked in on a branch way far up there, and then we vibrated it at 90 degrees out of phase and two different shakes down at the trunk. Here you can see the side-by-side motion of what happens at the top. It's pretty obvious here, these two limbs are moving in a very similar pattern, even though they're being shaken differently down at the trunk. This is fascinating, and I'm pretty sure a PhD student could easily write a thesis on simulating the complexity of a tree when modeled as a vibratory system. One thing I feel pretty confident in saying, though, is that it's probably not worth doing a second shake at 90 degrees, as it's clear almost no additional nuts end up falling from the tree. One thing that surprised me is you can clearly see the weight being released from the tree during shaking. It's almost like you can see the limbs climb up towards the sky as the burden is lifted from the branches and the nuts fall to the ground.
It's time to harvest. So this is the harvester, huh?
This is the harvester.
Okay.
See those round fingers?
Oh yeah.
Those stick down and they roll. They're a street sweeper kind of thing. And they sweep up the nuts. Fingers throw the leaves, throw the stuff up here.
Uh-huh.
They get on this belt and they go out the back. And the nuts will go into a hopper and they get, there's a big screw feed in here that feeds them up into that hopper. So the screw feed feeds them up into that hopper.
So somehow the nuts end up here?
Yeah, they get dropped off into this see this?
Oh, the basket.
In that basket, and then there's a screw feed. They come across and into here, and then they get scooped up.
Farmers like augers, don't they?
So the first thing Frank seems to do is pick up all the sticks in front of the harvester, because it's my understanding that the harvester can be affected negatively by sticks rolling up into these rubber fingers right here. So the path has to be completely clear of sticks.
We are taking nuts that we collected in the field in this trailer that you saw us load into.
Yeah.
And we're moving them from there into the hopper of this Southern Nut and Tree pecan cleaner. And it cleans the debris, leaves, husks off the nuts.
So Frank explained to me that the nuts are shoveled into a bin where they're fed onto a conveyor belt that makes its way up and then drops them down into a machine. Inside this machine, there are big rubber fingers which separate the leaves from the husks from the nuts, and then everything passes through a massive blast of air. All the leaves and the bad nuts get blown up and out of the machine into a big pile of baddies. The bad nuts are lighter than the good nuts because they've already been cracked and they've started to dry out. The good ones drop down onto another conveyor belt where humans further identify and separate out the bad ones. They're looking for mold or nuts with cracks in them, which means the inside could be compromised, or holes.
What is this?
A pecan weevil.
So that's the enemy.
That's the enemy. He bores in the hole in the husk, right through the husk, right into here. And then he'll live in here as a little worm.
So you have to be very adamant about looking for those guys.
You have to watch out for them.
So the final step is cracking the nut. And I've got to say, this machine is awesome.
So this is our cracker. It's a Quantz rotary cracker. Nuts go into this hopper. They go up this belt into the machine where it, you'll see.
Is it grabbing one nut at a time?
One nut goes in each of these little stations on the belt.
Really?
And what happens is they'll get pushed off here, and then there's a little wire that pushes them over so that they get kicked out, so there's only one per station.
Oh, index is just a single one time. Okay.
So then it's a pneumatic machine. We run compressed air into the machine here.
You have to finely tune this thing.
And so what happens is the nuts get picked up. They'll be held mechanically by a stainless steel cylinder, and it's stressed. It's under pressure. And then there is a pneumatic disc that is propelled again when it's under pressure, propelled against the end, that shatters the shell. And that shell is that.
I just figured something else. So the reason you're using air pressure is you can have constant force. Instead of like a spring, you'd have like displacement. It's a function of displacement. But with air pressure, you get constant force.
And we can adjust for a variety of size of nuts because it just squeezes whatever size nut comes through. So if you go to a Myers cracker down at the co-op, those crackers are set for a fixed space of cracking. So if the nut is big, if the nut's this big and they've got it set for a nut this size, it will still smash it down to this small and you will have a smashed half that's hardly worth it.
So this is force constant instead of displacement constant.
Right.
Exactly. That's amazing. Okay, exactly. I would have never thought about that. Okay.
Exactly. So here's the outside machine. You've seen the controls. This is what the inside looks like, and I'm going to open it up here so you can see it.
Oh, okay.
So, and what happens is, and you see all the debris, the nut gets picked up right here, and...
No way. Can you run it like this?
Yeah, we can.
Okay, this is good. I'm having to goggle up. That tells me that it's getting real.
Okay, goggle up. Pecan cracking's about to happen. Here we go.
Yeah, it happens really fast. We're running for just a minute so you can see it, and then we'll
cut it down.
Yep. And then some of these stations work better than others. We've had some problems, and we really need to do some major work with it. Here we go. You ready?
I'm ready.
What? That
That's amazing. That's awesome. Okay, and they come out here.
The real product comes out at this station in the discharge chute, and this person sorts that material out, looking for bad nuts and nuts that haven't cracked. This is overflow where the machine is a bit out of tune, and so stuff comes out the back that shouldn't.
Got it.
And these are all cracked, and then we take them from here and move them manually to her station where she does the final checks.
Got it.
Look at this. Wait. Look at the controls. You can see when they're working, crack changes, stress, feed pretty constant, inject pretty constant, and then reset. And then here, she's picking up the nuts, picks them up.
And it's kicking them out. If it's
if there's two on there, yeah. We're wired to push them up, so they index it properly. Okay?
How are they going in there?
Just gravity.
Got it.
Gravity keeps them at the bottom.
That's a finely tuned mechanical device, isn't it?
So this is the final product here?
Yes.
Okay, and what is the like normal quantity that you sell these things in?
3-pound bags for $20.
Okay, so this isn't like an industrial operation.
No, this is a mom and pop. Small farm operation, not making tons of money. If the IRS ever comes and audits us, they're going to say, "You doing this for what?"
So why do you do it?
You know, because the satisfaction is when you take pecans to people and they say, "These are the best pecans I've ever had." Uh-huh. That makes it worthwhile.
This episode of Smarter Every Day is sponsored by KiwiCo, and if you've been following Smarter Every Day for any length of time, you know that I originally reached out to KiwiCo because we love their products when this little girl was a whole lot younger than she is now. In past episodes on Smarter Every Day, I've told you about like the Tinker Crate and the Doodle Crate and all these other lines that KiwiCo has. But today we finally have access to the Eureka Crate and the Maker Crate. The Eureka Crate has to do with engineering and design, and the Maker Crate is all about art and design. These are awesome and they're geared more towards older kids.
I wanna try this bottom one, Macrame Planters.
So here's the deal. If you want to support Smarter Every Day, you can do so by getting a really cool kit delivered to your house for your kid. And I have a new promo code this time because I wanted to include the Eureka Crate and the Maker Crate in the deal. They're a little bit bigger. They're a little bit more complicated. You can see you actually get tools with them. So if you would go to kiwico.com/smarter50, that gets you 50% off your first crate. You get to pick whatever you want. And I really wanted the Eureka Crate and the Maker Crate to be a part of this.
So this is macrame. Did you know how to do that?
I do now.
If you have younger kids, by all means, the Tinker Crate is my favorite, but there's also like the Atlas Crate, the Doodle Crate. There's all different things you can choose from, and it's tailored specifically for your kid wherever they're at in life. Anyway, big thanks to you for supporting the sponsor, because when you do that, that supports Smarter Every Day and lets me make videos about things like pecans, things I find interesting. So, kiwico.com/smarter50, get a gift for someone you love or yourself.
So you're putting two pecans in your hand.
And just crack them.
Crack them together. You make them do the work.
Yeah, you have to have two.
All right, so we need to talk about something, Frank.
Yes.
You're saying pecan, and it's everybody knows it's pecan.
It's or pecan. You know, I've heard it pronounced three different ways in the two counties. Yeah, pecan, pecan, pecan. You know, you hear them all. So.
Okay, so. I'm going to bow to your authority. It's pecan in my mind, but I don't own a pecan shaker.
Pecan is fine.
Pecan is fine?
Pecan's fine.
I'm okay. Good. Okay, I'm okay. We're okay, Dad.
They're all good. Pecans, when we shake them, I don't want to leave the nuts on the ground because they'll get moldy.
And squirrels.
No, there's no squirrels here.
Oh, you a good rifle shot? No. He doesn't say. I bet you're pretty good with a .22.
We don't want to leave nuts on the ground.
Okay.